On this week's episode, I'm joined by Rachel Bonkink. Rachel is originally from Belgium, but has made her home in beautiful São Martinho de Porto on Portugal's Silver Coast. Rachel is a yoga and meditation instructor. She is the author of the book Flex Your Mind, and she was recently awarded by the Hall of Wellness as the best yoga practitioner in the UK and Europe. We discuss, amongst other things, why she finds her happy place and her zen right here in Portugal. Welcome back, or welcome to another episode of Portugal, The Simple Life. I'm really happy to be joined here by Rachel Bonkink. Rachel, am I saying the surname correctly?
You are. Thank you so much. Bonkink. It is a bit of an odd name, I know.
It's great. Namaste, and thank you for joining us.
Namaste. Thank you for having me. It's really fun to share my experience in Portugal and all that comes with it.
I'm looking forward to hearing about it all. But maybe you can start off just by telling us a little bit about you.
Good. Yes. So the last name, Bonkink, it's a Dutch name. So I was born in the Netherlands in a small town called Terneuzen. Should that ring a bell to some people? And then I was raised mostly in Belgium, so in Sint-Niklaas, which is between Antwerp and Ghent. So those cities usually ring a bell. And I was set out to have a nice corporate career. So I studied economics, master in economics, and then I had the corporate career. I was an operational director of a medical market research company. And I did this for 7 years, which was really nice. It was great. The only thing was that I was only working. It was only work. It was very fun flying around the world, doing lots of meetings, lots of stuff, but I was only working. And at a certain moment, and I see this now as a bit of a dark moment, I had the company car that I've always wanted. So it's like, okay, you work, you got that goal. And I still remember driving out of the garage with that thing. And I look to the right and I see the bigger model. I'm like, that is going to be the next one. And I mean, then we're talking, this is not a car anymore. This is like a tank. This is like, okay, that is going to be the next one. And there was no gratitude. There was only like blind ambition. It's like, that's going to be the next goal. More. And of course, ambition is great, but it became blind. So that made me think. And I quit. So I quit from one day to the other. Didn't know what I was going to do, but very cliche. Couldn't be more cliche. I went to India, did some volunteering work. Then I went to Bali. Then I went to Italy. So I did my eat, pray, love thing. I don't know if it's
exactly
the book or the film.
You ate and prayed and fell in love.
I did. Oh, I did. That's why I had to go to Italy to check if that would work. But that is, no, that didn't work.
That's another story.
That is another story. So yeah, then I started putting together everything that I liked. It's like, what am I going to do? But putting everything together that I liked before in my job, personally, I'm like, okay, I think I'm going to organize yoga retreats because I follow the yoga training in India. And it's like, yeah, I kind of like yoga, travel, being my own boss. It's like, okay, let's do that. So I started doing that. Did that for 9 years. Still do that, but there's a pre-COVID and a now. And then 4 or 5 years ago, I moved to Morocco. I was looking for a yoga venue, just like that. Like, I've been organizing these retreats all around the world. So Morocco, I thought it never rained in Morocco. It's like, I also thought it never rains in Portugal, but on both accounts, it does rain. And also in Morocco, it rains quite a bit. But I was just thinking this is a nice long season and I can do retreats from January till December. Then I came to this little fisherman's town, Essaouira. I looked around and I'm like, I could live here. Which made no sense whatsoever because I didn't know a single soul in Morocco. And then I thought, wait, this is a Muslim culture. this is nothing, I have nothing against them, but I was raised Catholic. It's like nuns' schools, like, what am I doing? But it just felt right. So I had a good coaching practice and yoga school in Antwerp, but I sold everything, gave everything away. And within 3 months, I moved. And why this whole story? Because last year when I came to Portugal, kind of the same happened. I looked around in São Martinho do Porto, where I am now. I'm like, this is a cute little town. I could live here. So kind of the same thing happened. And okay, we moved. Within a couple of months again, I'm like, oh, okay, let's move. There wasn't really a reason to move out of Morocco, but now that I'm here, I'm finding more and more reasons to be in Portugal. So it's very fun. And I also see that they're not that different. I mean, they're completely different, but there's many things that I recognize, which is nice, and made the transition also really nice.
One of the things that have popped up so often on the podcast is how people have somehow managed to find, well, not somehow, it's not so strange anymore now with all these conversations I've had, but that if people have managed to find similarities between where they're from and Portugal, it's almost like Portugal is this great adapter and somehow has managed to fit in with almost any culture, any belief, and people from all over those places and those cultures find a home in Portugal. And it's a really wonderful thing to see. Was that the first time you came to Portugal when you visited São Martinho?
No. When I look back, a long time ago, my mother already came to Portugal and she did these crazy juice fasts when that was still like a really new thing to do and it sounded like a great thing to do as well. So this was in the Algarve. Okay. And then she would lock herself up in a villa and they would have juices all day. And so she was already very excited about it. And then we visited Portugal, but always in the Algarve. And then I did some yoga retreats also. I think we started 3 years ago. And this was also more towards the south, Odeceixe area, which is a beautiful area. And so, yes, that kind of started sparking something there. It's like, ooh, this is a really nice country to be in.
What were those things that created the sparks for you?
For me, one of the main sparks is the Atlantic, and I'm pointing out there because that's where it is.
Very close to your place.
Definitely, yes. Yeah. I can hear it at night, which is beautiful. Great. So the Atlantic is very strong. I think that was also one of the reasons that I was attracted to Essaouira, which is also, I mean, same ocean. And then the coastal walks we've done on the retreats, there's always a nice walk included. And then I have a guide and it's just the nature there and just the robustness of this coastline is very, very strong. And then food wise, I mean, there's so much, I mean, organic stuff and it's just, it feels good. It tastes good. So those were the things that I was attracted to in the beginning. And then there's something, but that's more here, which is, this could be a bit weird, but there's this smell. So there's this smell that I also had in Morocco, but it's definitely here as well. And it just smells good here, which is a bit bizarre. But I think it is the mixture of the ocean and the humidity and the kind of plants that grow here. So one of the first things that I do in the morning is open the window and smell, which just gives me a sense of being at home, which is not sure how to explain that, but it's just like, that also attracted me here when I first came here.
Okay, first of all, you're going to have to be careful talking about food because you and I both have very sensitive microphones and our tummies are going to start grumbling and everyone will just hear this on the podcast. So we have to be careful. But the smell thing is interesting because I have clients from all over the world and one of the things that they always talk about here is the freshness of the air. And that clarity and not just looking, but the smell, the pureness, the purity. It's just so unpolluted here as well. Yeah. You know, it's just, you can smell nature where normally in most countries you've got nature, but it's the smell of nature is kind of blocked by the smell of the city or the smell of the town. And we don't have that here. We've got just the smell of nature. It's a beautiful thing. But I mean, you visited the Algarve a few times, but never were you down there thinking I could live here. You came to San Martinho de Porto and you thought, here I could live. What was it here that was different to there? What was it that grabbed you that you thought actually, because it's nice to go to a place on holiday and think, it's nice, I like it, but to come and say I could live here. And the reason I'm asking is because I had the exact same thing. The first time I came to San Martinho de Porto, I thought, yeah, this is it, you know? Mm. I saw the bay, the first time I saw the bay, and I thought I could live here. And what was it for you? What were those things that grabbed you that you thought, okay, this could be a home for me?
I'm not exactly sure what that is. I mean, it's rationally, I still can't explain exactly what that is. It is really more the feeling of belonging somewhere. So this feeling of being home. And I had the same thing. It's with looking at that bay, which the shelf-shaped bay is just, it is something special. And so to really put a lot of words to that is very difficult for me. It is really a feeling, and it just feels like coming home. And I still have that every day that I go to the beach. I'm like, ah, oh, yes, we have arrived. I've also started calling it my garden. It's like a bit on the possessive side, but I started calling it all my garden because that's how it feels.
Well, I always get funny comments because I love the village that I live in. I call it my village, and eventually people say, "Is it yours?" Like, well, it feels like it's mine, you know. So I get that, the my garden. But I heard a colleague of mine say something yesterday, which makes sense to what you're talking about. He says Portugal is something that you can't really put into words, but it's Portugal is something that you feel. That was like, wow. I was like, okay, that's sort of light bulb moment, because, you know, people will say, I mean, for you the same, and for me having lived here 10 years, people will say, why are you there? And it's difficult to put it into words, but it just, it's a place that feels right. You know, do you agree with that?
100%. It's like what I said in the beginning, the longer that I live here, the more reasons that I can find to live here. It's like, not that I calculated that in the beginning, this is the reason and that is the reason, but the longer that I'm here, I'm like, oh, this is also really nice, or this is also really nice. And now, of course, my integration has been like delayed, seriously delayed. I would like to visit there and there and there, but it's like with all the rules that we have now, and that we have to be a bit careful. But the more that I visit, I'm like, oh yeah, this is really nice. So I keep finding new reasons to be here, and that is, I think, really, really nice. I don't know how long I will be here, but it's just very nice to be here now.
Wonderful. We'll come. I want to come back and talk about your garden. Village. Yeah. But do you want to just tell us a little bit about, in terms of, you've got quite a few things going on with your yoga practice. There's a few exciting things. You're doing a couple of challenges because you can't do retreats at the moment. And you can talk a bit about that. Also, you have a book, which I'd love you to talk about after that. And then also your award. Congratulations. You're the yoga practitioner for UK and Europe. And then maybe you can, after the talking about the book, maybe you can tell us about how that came about as well.
Okay, yes. So for the past 9 years, I've been organizing yoga retreats. So it's coming together for 1 week. People from all over the world, they come together for 1 week. We've done several in Portugal, hope to do many more in the future, next year, the year after, we will see. But also like in Spain and in France, Italy, everywhere really. So that was great. People who are really into yoga, people who've never done yoga before, which is always really nice that they just dive in. And I've usually do 12 to 15 of those weeks per year. And then, so it was never my intention to like be here all the time in San Martino, but now it really has become home and I'm staying here a lot longer. And then with March this year happening, so no retreats, no travel whatsoever, so I started to do online retreats because I noticed that this is something that I really, really like, the teaching itself and to giving people that experience. Also the international part is not just about the yoga, it's not just about meditation, but it's bringing all those nationalities together, realizing that we're all the same. I mean, we're all emphasizing that we're so unique. We are, and at the same time, we're all the same. Mm. So that I really liked. I'm like, okay, how can we do that? So I think I was one of the first to launch online retreats in April, instantly. And then I asked the chefs that I work with to join me, and then also a nutritional expert to join me. So we made menus, and it was really nice from the start. It really hit off. So it's really cool to do. And we'll do several more. And we have done like 5, 6 now. So that's really cool. And then also I've started giving meditation in the morning. So in every month, so 30-day meditation challenges. And we all need challenges now, but in a way, the word challenge and the word meditation, they don't go together that well, but we're all in this mood of this challenge and that challenge. So I'm like, okay, we'll go with it. 30-day meditation challenge, where every day I guide people via Zoom 30 minutes into a guided session. So that is really, really nice. It can take people into pranayama techniques, so breath work first, and then concentration techniques, and then all kinds of different meditation techniques. And in 30 days, I really have the time to zoom in, to like have people experience, do mindfulness of breathing for 5 days and see what happens, and do this technique for 5 days and see what happens. And what is really nice is that people can ask questions, and that it can be really interactive the first 5 minutes or so. And then I guide. And the international aspect. So right now that we are at day 17 now, and we have 12 nationalities joining. So that's really, really nice. Also because we're all going through different stages. I mean, that one is going into lockdown. That one's coming out of lockdown. Other people are like, what virus? It's very interesting to come together for that. Wow. So that is what I do. The next one is in January. The 18th of January is Blue Monday. It's like the most depressive day of the year, it seems, because all your New Year's resolutions are one by one just going. And so I'll start on that day. It's like, let's try to bring a bit of joy. And then I still do the live coachings and teach yin yoga online. Every Wednesday I do that. And then the book is very exciting.
Tell us about the book.
The book is Flex Your Mind. So that is my idea, that you can flex your mind. You can change the way that you think. We are not our thoughts. And it's based on 10 principles of the yoga philosophy. So a lot of people think yoga is only about standing on your head, being super flexible, Instagram postures, but it is actually a lot more. And maybe the yoga philosophy inspired me even more to live the life that I'm living right now, or to be as passionate, but not blind ambition anymore, to be more conscious. So 10 principles, guidelines to create more peace of mind in a very stressful world. And today the audiobook is also out. So that is
wonderful,
cool, which is narrated by a lady, a sister, Winifred from Call the Midwife, which is very popular apparently in the UK.
Okay.
I had no idea, but it's out today.
I've heard about this series. I don't know it.
I've heard about it, but and it's really nice. I listened to it, and it's really nice.
So you went for the posh British accent to narrate your book. Good move.
Yes.
Good move. Americans will love it.
We'll see. I think she did a great job. It was very interesting to listen to my words in a very, very English accent.
Okay, so we're recording this on the 17th of December, and so your book's been released today.
Yep.
Wonderful. Congrats.
Thank you. And then the awards, yes, the awards, the Hall of Wellness Awards, which is quite a prestigious award. In the beginning, I had no idea it was that serious, but there was a 360 review, so from people all around me, and then there was a public voting even.
Wow.
I had to send in videos. There was an interview with a judge, so it was quite serious, and I was really pleased that I won it. Of course, just to win it, it's very good for the ego, but it was also really nice to get this award, because I don't advocate only the asanas, so only the postures. So in everything that I teach, I also tell people that it's about meditation, it's about well-being, it's more than just what is done on the mat. And I thought it was really nice that they chose me for that, because I'm not the typical yoga teacher as such. It's always about bringing in the elements of the yoga philosophy, about breath work and meditation. And there's loads of teachers nowadays who only teach the postures and they couldn't be bothered with meditation, in a way that doesn't really make a lot of sense. It's everything. So how mindful can you be in a posture? So I thought that was pretty cool that they gave me that award. And we'll see what happens next.
Congratulations. It's wonderful.
Thank you.
I mean, you teach people how to flex their minds. You teach them how to find balance, peace. Mm-hmm. You need to find that for yourself. You need that in yourself. I mean, we always talk about we have to listen to our own advice, I suppose. Mm. And does Salmotinho give you those things that you tell people to look for in terms of happiness, balance? Tell us a bit about that side of things for you.
Yes, definitely. So there was, I've had this comment once that somebody said, you took the easy way out. So you're out of corporate world and you retreated completely, and it's more difficult when you're still in it. And I don't think I chose the easy way out, but I do need to recharge a lot. Yeah. Myself to be able to give. So I think this is definitely what I'm doing here in San Martino. I give a lot. I'm very active, outgoing even. But after giving a retreat or leading meditation challenges or giving interviews or coachings, I really need to go over there to the garden and not talk to anyone. And yeah, meditate and have some good food. And it's the simple life, as you're saying, but that is what it is. It's really getting down to the basics and taking really good care of myself, because that is necessary. It's like everything that we do is like a Buddhist approach, but it's for the benefit of ourselves and others. The ourselves always comes first. It's like you can't serve from an empty cup, and all of those things, the oxygen from the airplane, it's like all of those things. You really have to recharge yourself first. And that is why I live where I live. That's why I don't live in Lisbon. Nothing against Lisbon. It's probably great to live if that's your thing. But to be in nature every single day, even now when it's very cold for me, it's still quite mild, but for me it's cold. To have my feet like barefoot in the sand, just to feel the sand, that recharges more than anything else. So
I think that having that space is really important, no matter what kind of career you're in, and especially when you're giving to people. So it's always nice to sort of come home to a place that re-energizes and rejuvenates us. And the bay is, I've got a picture of it here.
Yeah.
Behind us. The bay is just beautiful. What else do you want people to know about? I mean, we have to call it your terra now. You know, in Portuguese, they say minha terra, my land or my village. San Martinho is your terra. What do you want? What else do you want people to know about this little village and how special it is?
To when you visit it, to take a little bit of time to explore it also, because it, what is it, one street, two streets? I mean, the main thing where tourists come. And I did the very same thing the very first time that I came into this region. I stayed in Nazaré, so next door. And I came here and I drove through with the car. I'm like, what's this? So in the car, just driving through, you just see a couple of shops, you see three big buildings, and that's it. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, that was it. This San Martino. And then it really needs a little bit of time to really explore it, to walk to the end of the bay, to walk to the end of the other side, to check things out, to see the little boats, and to sit down and to look at that bay. It really needs a little bit of time to just sit down and take it in. And then you start seeing more things. Well, it's not that you start visualizing weird things, but you start seeing you start seeing the shapes of the hills, and you start seeing, and there's so much seaweed every now and then. It's like, but it needs a little bit of time, because in a way there's nothing to see. There's no big museums, there's no big statue, there's nothing extraordinary. But once you sit down and just explore, it's like, okay. And then you see the people who live here. It's like, okay, this got quite a chilled atmosphere. Or you see the same people on the boulevard. And that is just, but that needs a little bit of time, and not just like 10 minutes of driving through and parking your car. It's like, then maybe you don't get it. So yeah, and walking through the old little city. So it needs a little bit of time. So that would be the advice you'd give to people. Yes.
Yeah, the old town is beautiful. I love that walk. I don't know if you've been past that bakery. Yep. That does the pastel nata.
If there is one thing that is maybe negative about Portugal, it's those things.
Yes, I know.
Those are not good for you. Those are like gluten-free, sugar-free, dairy-free. Nah, none of that.
No. I mean, look, they were developed by the monks, you know, and all that they had was sugar and egg, so and flour. So it's made of all the best stuff.
I'm not against them. It's just, yeah. Yes, it's maybe not the best choice for every day.
Not for every day. You mentioned going on walks and how that personally helps you with, you know, just getting re-centered, getting re-energized. And you also mentioned how when you spend some time in San Martino, you start to see it from different perspectives and different ways. And the bay is one of those things where there's so many different ways to enjoy the bay and to see it. We've got lookout points on either side. We've got walks that go up and down the ridges. Have you done any recently that you can tell us about, where you just were like, wow, that is the view is beautiful, or the outlook to the ocean, the Atlantic?
The part that I really like is where you go up in Salir, so the dune of Salir. So that is nice too. Every now and then I do that just to check the fitness level, just run up. And maybe even the running down is even more fun, because only the kids do that. But if they then have an adult doing that, that's even more fun. So to go up there and then go to the right to, where we had the ruins, but now it's rebuilt. So that's really nice to visit, a little chapel. So you could go that way. But what I always, or what I tend to do, is to go to the other side. Mm-hmm. So to keep walking straight, and then you get the other side. So on the left, let's say, of the chapel, and then you have a nice view to the bay. So to the opening, the same thing as what you look at from the beach side, but you see the opening from another side. And it's quite a special view. And if I then start walking along the coast, let's say to Foz, so to the other sides, but
to the stay south.
To stay on that side, there's quite a few interesting meditation spots, I must say, to just sit. And you can find places where there's hardly any wind, There's hardly any people, so I'm not sure how many people listen to this podcast, but there were hardly any people. Maybe now it's very busy.
Don't you find that that's so amazing that we're in this place where, you know, this bay, I mean, I haven't seen one like it in the world. You know, it's just completely unique. It's naturally formed that way. It's not man-made. So you've got this beautiful sort of feat of nature, most amazing beaches and little coves, and you won't see anybody for miles and miles. And it's amazing that that still exists today in today's world, where people can go anywhere and travel anywhere. I know at the moment we're in quieter times with the pandemic, but even before that, you can find little beaches, little coves where you will not see another human being for miles. And I think that's just incredible.
It is. It really is, because I've been walking so much, and it's like hardly that you meet someone there. So it's really, really nice. Yep.
What about the rest of the country? I mean, are there places that I know you mentioned that you're planning to possibly do future events in Portugal? So I'm sure you've sort of started to look at exploring different places. What are other places in Portugal that you'd like to visit and explore?
I need to see everything. In just 1 year, I haven't seen, I mean, it's hardly worth mentioning because we didn't have the opportunity to travel. But what I have seen, for example, I have a friend who's just 3 hours north from here. And
where's that
area,
Rachel?
It's 3 hours north, 3 hours north, and then towards the south. So it's before towards the center. So it's before, I forgot the name. Clearly. Okay. I will think about it. It's a very nice area. It's got hills, but it is very different already. So it's like going to a very different place. Everything seems to be different. And then Alentejo, of course, I have visited, and hopefully we'll do a retreat there in June. So also there, even now, sometimes the weather is completely different. Mm-hmm. I'll be saying, well, it's a bit fresh here, it's a bit cold. And the owner of the venue is like, no, it's been beautiful here. It's like 30 degrees. I'm like, 30 degrees. And the same with the friend in the north. It was so warm in the summer, while here it was like 20 degrees, she was in 30, and now the opposite. It's extremely cold there, and here it's still rather mild. So what are other places? I mean, one day in Coimbra, one day in Porto, but it's like that needs a lot more exploration, because I dare to say that I don't know anything in Portugal yet. Anything. It's like, okay, I think I know the bay a little bit, but that's about it. Really?
Yeah.
So I can't wait to start exploring.
Yeah, there are so many places. You know, I mean, this place is special somewhat to New Porto, but there's just, it comes back to that thing of it's a place that just makes you feel, you know, and it's not a place that you can understand. It's a place that you can feel. And there's just so many beautiful places. I can imagine you doing a great yoga retreat on a sunset in Alentejo. The sunsets in Alentejo are like African sunsets. They're just magnificent because it's flat and you've got these little rolling hills. And it's peaceful and quiet, and it's just there's so many places that are exciting to think about.
Mm, yeah, I mean the places that I look for is also, so it's how it makes me feel. But even in the other countries, I've always tried to visit the venues or the houses or whatever it is that I'm renting for the retreats, to visit them first and to sit there and to just feel and to have a chat with the owners, to connect, to see how they came about. And they don't need to be into yoga per se, but it's like, what makes you do what you do? What is your intention with this venue? And why here? Why not there? And that's really important. So what I've seen so far in Alentejo was really, really nice. Odissej as well. There was a whole philosophy behind that. And there's many other places. I mean, loads of good initiatives everywhere in Portugal. So can't wait to start visiting.
Yeah. A question. I mean, you've you've been exposed obviously to sort of the Belgian Dutch background. You've traveled a lot for work, as you mentioned earlier. You've been to Morocco. There's something that I find quite unique here in Portugal is the accessibility to people. They're mm-hmm. just open to have a conversation, no matter who they are, no matter what level they are in a company, at an organization, at a venue. Do you find the same thing, that people are just open to talk and to work together, to find a way to work and also that they're really curious about your story and about who you are? Don't you find that here in Portugal?
Definitely. I was just going to say the word curious when you said it. It's like, it is curious, or just really wanting to know. It's like, why do you move here? What is it really trying to understand? It's like, for us, it's all normal. And it's like, yeah, they're quite surprised sometimes. They're like, well, this is not that normal. Or taking the time for certain things, taking the time to have a chat. And it's not like, okay, we only have like 10 minutes to do this or to do that. That's probably also one of the things that I like, is like the takeaway culture, like takeaway coffee is like, doesn't exist.
No.
Why would you do that? This is like, that makes no sense. And it doesn't make any sense. Some people take an espresso to go. It's like, an espresso to go? Why would you sit down, have a chat? Who are you? Where are you from? It's like, that's something that I noticed here, which is brilliant. This is also something, and I try not to always compare with Morocco, but the same thing. They don't have takeaway. It's like, why would you have takeaway? Take it. That's very important. You have your coffee there, more tea, but okay, you have your coffee and a load of sweets next to it, and let's have a chat. Same with food. You hardly see people walking around here eating. It's like, no, for food, you sit down. I mean, preferably with other people. And then you can talk. So yes, definitely. So I also can't wait to start talking a little bit more Portuguese. I'm quite good with languages, but Portuguese is just quite difficult for me right now. But I followed the first course, so I can't wait that you can really dive into the language as well, because that's when you really start understanding people. And I've saw on your Instagram as well all these funky ways to say certain things. It's like all these proverbs who, like, okay, this is really interesting. Then you get to know people. It's like, okay, I didn't know Portuguese had such humor, or I didn't know this or that. Yeah. So you can learn a lot more through language.
Oh, they've got some beautiful sayings that you'll learn. If you can learn a couple of those, you'll impress. You'll have people really impressed, like, oh, wow, she knows this. You've got ones called fate au beef, which means you're screwed. You say das fate au beef, which means it means you're done to the boat, to the meat. So it's just, yeah. And then they've got ones, a lot of them about food, obviously, you know, as you can imagine. Yeah. But a question, I mean, you mentioned the pastries are very dangerous.
Yes.
How good is the coffee? How good is the coffee here?
The coffee is good. It's good.
It sounds like there's a bat coming.
I'm very used to the Italian coffee.
Okay.
There is a difference still. And here it depends a little bit on where you have the coffee. And in Italy, you can't generalize, but in most cafes, bars, wherever you go in Italy, you get a good one. And here, not always, but the coffee is good. I like coffee. I've experimented quite a bit. It's good.
Okay, we're gonna move on, because otherwise you're gonna get.
Yes, I'm gonna get so much.
Edit this part out.
This is gonna be edited. Yes.
No, not at all. Don't worry. Wonderful. What are you excited about for the future coming up for you and what you're doing, and just you and Portugal in the next while? What are you looking forward to?
What I'm really looking forward to is finding some new venues so that I can tell people to come to Portugal whenever it's safe and we're allowed and all that. So to explore some new venues. I'm seeing a new venue in on Saturday. So just checking those out, seeing how it feels. And it's nice to invite people to the place where I live. I did the same with Morocco, organized 6-7 yoga retreats per year in Morocco. So I hope to do the same here. And then for me personally, to explore, to just go around the country and then see a little bit the north, the south, the east, the west. So just explore a little bit. The meditation challenges are continuing. There is quite a bit of life coaching, and because it's very nice to be able to support people, and there's a lot of tension, a lot of anxiety. So it's nice to show people a little bit of a way, give some guidance. So that is really nice. And just to be here, really, it's just very nice to be here and to have some people over as well, because it's like I've got one spare bed which nobody has ever slept on it. I mean, that was not the idea. So the idea was that quite a few people would come and visit me, of course, but that hasn't happened. So I'm looking forward to that, to just showing people around. Everybody has the same question: why here?
Yeah.
Why not there? Why not here? Why this country? And then it's like, okay, just come and have a look, and let's just sit on the beach, and then you'll probably see. I'm a vegetarian, but have a fish and have this and have some good food. Have some chicken. The chicken apparently is amazing here. So it's like, okay, let's just experience it, and then you'll probably find out why I'm here.
Yeah, I've had that with when I first moved. I had family sort of saying why, and then once they, family and friends, and once they came and visited, you know, we'd be sitting somewhere and they'd go, okay, I get it. You know,
I get
so
it. Yeah.
It's your happy place.
Definitely. Yes. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Wonderful. Rachel, three things that you want people to remember or take away from our conversation.
Come and visit Portugal whenever we can, whenever it's allowed. That it's important to find your happy place, to like have with the yoga, meditation. I mean, I encourage people to do that, but if it's something else, just find a moment for yourself every day to find that little sense of peace of mind every day. And then there's nothing really to reach for to be happy or to be joyful, but living in a nice place does help. A lot of people don't realize that you can actually move and that it's not such a big deal as we sometimes think. And especially not in a country like Portugal. Maybe things go a bit slow, but it's all relatively easy to move or to find a house, to integrate. So it's not that difficult as we sometimes think. So that might be something to remember.
Wonderful. Thank you. How can listeners find you online, follow your work, and also buy your book?
So the book is online just about everywhere. You can just flex your mind. If you type that in, we can go for the big ones, or you can have your local bookstore order it. That's also possible. And then the website is www.rachelbonkink.com, or Instagram. I'm quite active on Instagram as well. Same, my name.
Wonderful. Yeah, you've got lots of good photos of your garden.
Of my garden.
The bay,
yes.
on your Instagram. It's great. Rachel, a question that we ask all of our guests. Portugal, the simple life. Why?
Because simple, in the end, has a lot more richness to it. It's in the simple things. Happiness and joy is in the simple things. That's why. It's simple.
Beautiful. Thank you very much. Rachel, good luck with everything. I've enjoyed this conversation. Well, I'm sure we'll have a coffee sometime soon. We're neighbors.
Yes.
So I look forward to seeing you out and about. But for now, I'm going to let you call it.
That's a wrap.
So thank you once again to Rachel, and thank you to all of you for listening. Please subscribe, share with your friends, give us a thumbs up, and please leave a comment or a review. We'd love to hear from you. And as we say in Portugal, um abraço. Welcome to the simple life.